Let's say financial relations, capital structure. Okay, fine. So what is capital structure for a company? So generally, if a company needs funds for long-term running, correct? No, it's called long-term resources the company required. So if a company has to think, if we want to run the company for long-term view, we need funds. Where the funds comes from? Debenture. The company can raising the funds through debenture route. Debenture, which means the company can borrow loans, or company can issue preference shares, or company can issue equity shares, or company may have retained earnings. So these are the generally four sources. Debenture means some loan, bank loan or debenture issue, right? So in order to form company's capitalization, capital structure means mix of capitalization through debentures, through preference shares, through equity shares, through retained earnings. So overall comes around total capital structure. That's it. Total capital structure. While choosing a suitable financing plan pattern, certain factors are to be taken. Suppose the company going to raise debentures, preference shares, equity shares, retained earnings. So what is the cost involved? What kind of risk the company has to face? See, generally, we have borrowed loan. The loan has been put into effective usage, you know. Otherwise, no use at all. Okay. Now, risk factor is one of the important things. There are certain factors like cost involved, risk involved. What kind of control we have to apply? Anytime the cost will not be exceeding the return. You are trying to maintain it. Try to maintain the control. Sometimes what happens, cost of capital will be more than the return. Okay. Now, you have to maintain the balance. For this, we need control. And other flexibility we required. Okay. Right. For this, every type of industry depends upon the industry type. And the competition industry also will be taken into account to think about the factors like cost of capital, risk of capital, how the control has to be done, what kind of flexibility we can apply, the mix of structure. So it may be differ from industry to industry based on the competition also. That's it. Next, what are the capital structure theories available in general? Okay. So generally different theories have been established in financial point of view in different period of time. Okay. But they're common, they have only one relationship for all theories. What are the relationship between cost of capital? The capital structure consists of debenture, preference shares, equity shares, retained earnings. That's called capital structure and the value of the firm. Every structure consists of what is the cost involved for raising the funds for long-term flexible stability, and how the capital structure is supposed to be debenture, preference shares, equity shares, and retained earnings. Number four, value of the firm. So these are the three interrelationships, the cost of capital, capital structure, and value of the firm. That's it. Next one is called net income approach. Number one, net income approach. So number one approach is net income. We have sums also available. We'll see later on. Little bit I'll tell you about what is net income approach. That's it. And net operating income approach. Net operating income is nothing but EBIT, earning before interest and taxes. That's it. So net income, EBIT minus interest, EBT minus tax, PAT. So PAT, net income either maybe before tax means EBT or after tax means PAT. Before tax EBT, after tax PAT. Okay, profit after tax, earning before tax. And number three approach is called modicum minimum approach, used to call MM approach. See, all the approach have a common one point agenda. What is the point of agenda? What kind of relation between the cost of capital and the capital structure and the value of the company, firm value? So cost of capital, capital structure, value of the firm, they try to find the relationship. Okay. Number four, the traditional approach. Number five, trade-off theory. Number six, pecking order theory. Different theory. But anyway, examination point of view, we are going to see only for these kind of theories. Net income, net operating income, Modicum Miller approach, we are going to see. So these are the familiar capital structure theories. So all the theories, they have a common relationship. What is the cost of capital for debenture, preference shares, equity share, return earnings? What kind of capital does a company possess or having? What is the value of the firm? Market capitalization of the firm. So company raising the debenture, preference, what is the market value of the firm? They try to find the value of the firm, right? Ultimate aim. Any relationship with cost of capital, capital structure, and value of the firm, right? Next, EBIT, EPS analysis, you have to find it. Earning before interest and taxes and earning before interest and taxes, and earnings per share analysis to be done. EBIT, EPS analysis to be done. EBIT, EPS to be analysis to be done. Okay, right. So that's called indifference point approach. Indifference point. Okay, right. How to do it? That's a general structure. Already we are familiar with this. So sales minus variable cost, which means material, labor, and overheads. So sale minus variable cost, that is equal to contribution minus fixed cost is equal to earnings before interest and taxes, EBIT, earning before interest and taxes. Can you pay minus interest? Minus interest, EBIT minus interest is equal to EBT. So minus tax is equal to PAT, profit after tax, minus preference dividend, that is equal to earnings. Okay. So earnings per share is equivalent to earnings per share EPS is equal to these earnings will be transferred to number of equity shares outstanding. Can I divide the earnings to number of equity shares outstanding? You'll be getting earning per share. Earning per this is called EPS. So sales minus variable cost contribution minus fixed cost EBIT minus interest EBIT minus tax profit after tax minus preference dividend earnings. This is vertical approach. Same thing I can do it by horizontal approach. Horizontal approach. EBIT minus interest. EBIT minus interest. Interest into 1 minus tax rate. EBIT minus interest. EBT into 1 minus tax rate. PAT is a PAT so far. PAT minus preference dividend. Minus preference dividend by number of equity shares outstanding. We can call it as N1 EPS. This is vertical approach. Vertical approach is horizontal approach. Horizontal. EBIT minus interest. EBT minus tax. PAT minus PD earnings by numerator is earning. Now the numerator is earning by number of equity shares outstanding is called denominator. If you divide the numerator by denominator, you'll be getting earning per share. Vertical approach. Okay. What do you mean by indifference point? Indifference point. Point of indifference. Suppose the company having a two plan. So plan one, plan two, plan two. Plan one, plan two. The company having two plans. Under two plans, the first plan consists of equity and debt. Second plan consists of equity, part debt, part preferences. Part preferences. Okay, right. So under the plan one, plan two, both same capital structure only. Okay. I mean total amount required is same, but we are raising the funds through equity and debt. Here we're raising the funds to equity, debt, and preference share capital. That's the idea. That's the idea. Okay. Anyway, you are going to find out EPS here for the given structure. Here also you have to find EPS for given structure. You may call the plan one as the EPS one. Plan 2 as a EPS 2. Anyway, EPS 1 is equal to EPS 2. You have to find the level of EBIT. It's called indifference point. What is EPS 1 formula? EPS 1 formula. The same thing. EPS 1 formula. EBIT minus interest 1. Interest 1. Debt is available. Of interest 1. Different debt, different interest. Interest 1 into 1 minus tax rate minus preference dividend 1, PD 1. Preference dividend 1, PD 1. Preference shareholders, you have to pay preference dividend. Okay. So PD 1. So by number of equity shares outstanding, it is going to be N1. Similarly, EBIT minus interest to EBIT minus interest to EBIT minus interest to into 1 minus tax rate minus PDD preference dividend 2 by number of equity shares outstanding N2. This is N2. Okay, right. So this is EPS 1 is equal to EPS 2. So by equating these two, EBIT minus interest, EBT minus tax, PAT minus PD earnings by number of equity shares outstanding, EPS 1. Same thing, EPS 2. If EPS 1 is EPS 2 equal, then the level of EBIT you have to find out, that is called indifference point. So level of EBIT you have to find out, that's called indifference point. It is called indifference point. So it's called indifference point. That's it. Now, indifference point. Level of EBIT that is equivalent to indifference point. That's it. Okay. Right. So this is indifference point, point of indifference. Okay. Okay, now we'll come back. EBDP analysis. The basic object of financial management is to design appropriate capital structure, which can be provide the highest earning per share or the firm's expected range of earnings EBIT. Of every shareholder to become happy, now you have to pay highest EPS, earning per share. More earnings, the more EPS for a shareholder. Okay, that's your idea. In this case, what happened? The more EPS you have to give, now wealth you're creating the shareholders. Which means less interest you have to pay, less tax you have to pay. So therefore, more earnings for the equity holders. So EPS means earning per share maximizes the wealth of the shareholder. It is a measure of the firm's performance for the investor. Okay. Investor invested in equity shareholders. How much earnings per share we are giving to them? So the EBIT vary from year to year. Every year the EBIT will differ. First year to second year, EBIT will differ. EBIT EPS analysis is a vital tool for designing the optimal capital structure of the firm. It's a very important tool, EBIT EPS analysis. That's called indifference point or point of indifference. This is a point of indifference. Okay, right. Point of indifference. EPS 1 under capital plan 1, EPS 2 under plan 2, both capital structure remain same. Then EPS and EPS 2 also is same. But then what about EBIT? Question mark. That's called indifference point. But what level of EBIT, earnings per share under plan 1, earning per share under plan 2 must be equal. It is called indifference point. What level of EBIT? Earnings per share 1, EPS 1 under plan 1, EPS 2 and the plan 2 must be equal. That's it. That's called indifference point. Okay. Appo the maximum EB is very, very important for every company, every corporate. It just gives the maximum performance for the investors, right? So the objectives of this analysis is to find the EBT level. EBT level that equal to the EPS regardless of the financial plan chosen. Okay. So automatically EBT and EPS will be equal. If EPS is equal, now what is EBT? If EPS is equal, now what is EBT? Right. What do you mean by overcapitalization? We are going to see later on. It is a situation a firm has more capital invested into the business than it needs more investment into the business. But the earnings are insufficient to pay dividend and interest. Say they are not active. They have more money. They are not active. So their earnings are insufficient, not enough. They are not earning properly. More money invested, less earnings, overcapitalization. More money invested, less earnings, overcapitalization. Because of overcapitalization, so they are insufficient to pay dividend and interest. Insufficient money is available. Out of EBIT only, you have to pay interest. EB is not sufficient. Out of earnings only, you have to pay dividend. Earnings not sufficient. So more investment, less earnings. Because of less earnings, we are unable, insufficient dividend, insufficient interest we are paying. That's it. Which means our assets are worthless. We are not effectively put into the asset. See, more money invested, but where is the return? Where is the dividend? Not earnings are not enough. No, overcapitalization. So more capital be invested than it requires. More investment, more earning must be there. No, more investment, but low earnings. So earnings are insufficient to pay dividend and interest. Overcapitalization. What is undercapitalization? Reverse of overcapitalization. That's it. So here the capitalization will be lower, rather than warranted is earning capacity. Reverse it. So undercapitalization, it is lower. Actual capital is lower than the proper capitalization. So every company need a proper capitalization. This capitalization, this earnings required. But this proper capitalization, we are not invested. Lower capitalization invested. That's it. Is actual capitalization lower than the proper capitalization? For this capitalization, this earnings required, but this much of capitalization we are not invested under capitalization. So actual capitalization is lower than proper capitalization. So because of this, so this capitalization is required now for the investment. This much of earning capacity, this much of capitalization not done. This much of earning capacity is not done because your actual capital is lower than the proper capitalization. It's called undercapitalization. Let's see, 2007 and 2008, two times the question has been asked. Okay. The question is, what is optimal capital structure? And explain the concept. Optimal capital structure. So generally, what is capital structure of a company? I told you earlier, debt, equity, preference shares, and dividend earnings. That's the capital structure for the company. Every company, they have only one thought process. That's called, their capital structure will be optimum. And the firm value should be maximum. Cost of capital and cost of debt and equity, minimum. Market price, maximum. Value, maximum. That's the goal of every company. Value of the firm must be maximum. Capital structure will be optimum. Cost of debt, cost of equity, minimum. Market price, maximum. Wealth creation, maximum. That's the ideology of every firm. On that process, only every company is operating upon. Optimal capital structure means the company having the following features. Number one, your profitability should be maximized. Using the minimum cost, you leverage using the minimum cost to maximize your profit. Minimize the cost to maximize your profit. That's the mantra number one for every organization. Minimize the cost to maximize the profit. Number two, flexibility. Okay, right. So the structure, optimal structure, capital structure will be flexible in a such a way the company may be able to raise funds whenever it is required. So don't raise every money often. Requirement rise, otherwise reduce. Don't raise the money. Okay. Requirement now raise the money. Otherwise, don't raise the money. Okay, raise. So structure should be so flexible. Company may be able to raise funds or reduce funds whenever it is required. You can raise funds or reduce funds whenever it is required. That's it. Number three, control. It should reduce the risk of dilution of control. So every country, everything. Okay. Automatically, there is a risk available. Risk of dilution of control. You try to reduce it. Always, every company. So they try to reduce the risk of control. Risk. Every organization, they are going to face the risk. Operating risk, financial risk, combined risk. So every different days of risk the company has to face. So the risk has to be minimized by having a controlling. More focus on your control, risk will be minimized. More control, less risk. More control, less risk. That's it. Similarly, solvency. Solvency. If a company having a more debt, definitely there's a question mark. Question mark or the repayment capacity. Repayment capacity. It is going to threaten the solvency of the company. The company can survive for next 10 years. Next 5 years, the company can survive. Solvency factor. Solvency factor. The company not able to survive. Insolvency. Company can able to survive. Solvency. Solvency. But the company having a more debt, there is a threat of solvency. The company have more threat, debt, loan. The company have more loan. The threat of solvency. Threat of solvency. That's very important. More debt, threat of solvency. According to this, if a company takes on debt, the value of the firm increases up to a certain point. Upper maximum, company can go cheaper debt. Cheaper debt. Once a company going for cheaper debt, the firm value is going to start. So that is the concept available in the capital structure theory. Is the company having a loan, more value in the market. The company having a loan, more value for the firm, company in the market. A company having no debt, low value. Company having a more debt, more value. More debt, more value for the company. No debt, low value for the company. So the company will have to start decrease. Okay. So definitely every company they're going for aspiring for getting a loan to increase the value. But beyond a point, loan is not okay. See, low, there are two types of loan. One is called good loan, another is called bad loan. What is good loan? Your repayment capacity is good. That's a good loan. Your repayment capacity is bad. Up a bad loan. You're not using the loan properly. Bad loan. So value of the firm will start to decrease. Start to decrease. That's the point. Start to decrease. Up a beyond a certain point, loan is okay. Beyond a point, loan is not okay. Not okay. Automatically, firm value will decrease. Repayment capacity diminishes. Value of the market down. Insolvency going to threaten the firms. It is going to threaten the firm. Insolvency. Up a certain point, debt is okay. Beyond a point, debt is not okay. That's it. The company unable to pay the debt within the specified period, then the goodwill of the company is dampened. It is going to be affected. Company borrowed loan. That is what happened to Reliance Groups. Younger one. The company borrowed loans. Unable to repay the money, company goodwill down. So debt is a edge, knife of the edge, knife edge. You have to use the knife properly. Otherwise, knife will cut your fingers. So just like a knife edge, loan is nothing but knife edge. Use the loan properly. Otherwise, just cut your finger. Just like this, okay? Suppose you are unable to pay the debt within the specific period, your goodwill value will be diminished, affected. Hence, company should select up to proper capital structure and due consideration all other factors. Of every company should have to think about how much capital structure percentage they try to hold it. So 60% debt, 40% equity, up to the company decide. No, sir. 40% debt, 40% equity, 20% preference shares, go for it. So the upper capital, the company can design, company can think upon. So upper capital, the company can depend, think upon. That's it. Okay, well, fine. That's the idea. Right. Okay. Let's see. 2010, 2 marks. What do you understand by the capital structure? How does it differ from the financial structure? What is capital structure? What is financial structure? So capital structure is nothing but combination of various sources of funds the company is using for earmarking the long-term operations. The company going for long-term, they need debt, they need equity, they need preferential, they need redemption earnings for long-term operations. So it's a combination of debt, equity, the company uses to finance its long-term operations. It's called capital structure. Long term, the company going to operate, we need capital structure. Combination of debt and equity instruments. It is a permanent financing of a company. Long-term source of the capital, the company going to raise it. It including owners' equity, shareholders' funds, long-term loans, debentures, bank loans, excluding current liability. Current liability, short-term obligation, the company going to meet. So they're getting a short-term debt. Company having a short-term loan, current liability. The company having a long-term loan, long-term source of funds. Company have owner's equity, long-term source of funds. The company have long-term debt, long-term source of funds. The company have current liability, no, it is not a long-term. It is going to meet obligation only for current debt, current. So within 1 year, you have to repay current liability. So bank OD, it borrowed. Within 1 year, you have to repay the current liability. That's it. Capital structure means long-term operations, how much fund they're going to raise optimally, but it is excluding current liability. So what is financial structure? Enter left-hand side of the balance sheet. All the long-term and long-term, short-term shows of capital is a financial structure. It's a financial structure. Financial structure means only left-hand side of the balance sheet, which means long-term source of capital, short-term, both. போத் ஃபினான்ஷியல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் மீன்ஸ் லாங் டேர்ம் லயபிலிட்டி லாங் டேர்ம் ஃபண்ட்ஸ் பிளஸ் கரண்ட் லயபிலிட்டி பிளஸ் கரண்ட் லயபிலிட்டி கரண்ட் லயபிலிட்டி தட் இஸ் ஈக்குவல் டு ஃபினான்ஷியல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் இன் கேஸ் ஆஃப் ஆப்டிமல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் ஆப்டிமல் கேபிட்டல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் கேபிட்டல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் வாட் காம்பினேஷன் ஆஃப் டெட் வாட் காம்பினேஷன் ஆஃப் ஈக்விட்டி வாட் காம்பினேஷன் ரிட்டர்ன் எர்னிங்ஸ் ப்ரெஃபரன்ஸ் கம்பெனி கோயிங் டு ரைஸ் ஃபார் லாங் டேர்ம் பெனிஃபிட்ஸ் கேபிட்டல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் ஃபினான்ஸ் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் லாங் டேர்ம் ஃபண்ட் ஜென்ரேஷன் ஷார்ட் டேர்ம் ஃபண்ட் ஜென்ரேஷன் ஆல் டுகெதர் ஃபினான்ஷியல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் ஆல் டுகெதர் ஃபினான்ஷியல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் சேம் ஐ டோல் யூ ஆல்ரெடி சேம் திங் சேம் பாயிண்ட்ஸ் ஸோ கேபிட்டல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் கம்பெனி இஸ் காம்பினேஷன் ஆஃப் டிபெஞ்சர்ஸ் லாங் டேர்ம் டெட் ப்ரெஃபரன்ஷியல் கேபிட்டல் ரிட்டர்ன் எர்னிங்ஸ் காம்பினேஷன் combination all the permutation combination can apply how much dependent percentage you may have how much long term debt you may have how much preference capital you may have how much retained you may have it's a permanent financing of the firm long term definitely you can repay the loan after 3 years or after 5 years preference shares net worth equity shares so they won't disturb you by short term long term only so a long term financing of the company is called capital structure Ordinary plus the proportion of debt and equity, how much percentage you're going to raise for the company's long-term obligation. What is your total capital? Where are the money can be tapped? Okay. What kind of money it consists of? Preference capital, equity, return earnings, and loans, debentures. So capital structure should be planned generally in keeping in view interest of equity holders and the financial requirements of the company. When the company really requires money, you raise the funds. Don't really require the money, don't raise the funds. Starting capital structure is nothing but it's a financial plan. Appropriate debt equity mixer, the company try to have it. Anyway, the ultimate idea, minimize the cost of capital. KO, WCC. Overall cost of capital, you try to minimize it. Maximize the market price share of the company. Maximize the total value of the firm. Minimize the cost. Maximize the profit. Maximize the return to the shareholders. Maximize the wealth creation of the shareholders. That's it. Ultimate aim, minimize the cost. Maximize the market price, maximize the value creation to shareholders, maximize the value of the firm, maximize the profitability. That's it. Ultimately, minimize the cost, maximize the worth or maximize the wealth. One time agenda. Two important things for any capital structure, any point of time. Ultimate aim. What is the ultimate aim? Minimize the cost. Maximize the wealth. Maximize the profit. Maximize the net worthiness of the shareholders. Maximize the firm value. That's it. Minimize the cost, maximize the worth. That's it. Okay. Let's see 2002. State three assumptions under Modigliani-Miller approach to cost of capital. What is Modigliani-Miller approach to cost of capital? What the agenda for the cost of capital? Okay, right. So theory, Franco Modigliani and Meron Miller, that's called MM. Modigliani-Miller is called MM approach. Modigliani and Miller, MM. MM approach developed by hypothesis. Which is actually extension of net operating income approach, operating income, EBIT. Net operating income is called EBIT, earning before interest and taxes. So MM model is based on EBIT. According to this theory, here, corporate tax is in the absence of corporate tax, in the absence of cost of capital, and the market value of equity shares is independent to the changes in the capital structure of a degree of leverage. Suppose no corporate tax, assumption, no cost of capital, assumption, and market price of share is independent to changes in capital structure, independent. அப்போ மார்க்கெட் வேல்யூ ஆஃப் தி ஷேர் இஸ் இண்டிபெண்டன்ட் ஆஃப் தி கேபிடல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் சேஞ்சஸ் பிகாஸ் தேர் இஸ் நோ டாக்ஸ் தேர் இஸ் நோ காஸ்ட் ஆஃப் கேபிடல் இஃப் தேர் இஸ் நோ டாக்ஸ் தேர் இஸ் நோ காஸ்ட் ஆஃப் கேபிடல் ஈக்விட்டி ஷேர் வேல்யூ இஸ் இண்டிபெண்டன்ட் டு தி சேஞ்சஸ் இன் கேபிடல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் இண்டிபெண்டன்ட் தே ஆர் டிஃபரண்ட் ஆர் டிகிரி ஆஃப் லிவரேஜ் இஃப் தேர் இஸ் நோ டாக்ஸ் தேர் இஸ் நோ காஸ்ட் ஈக்விட்டி ஷேர் வேல்யூ இஸ் இண்டிபெண்டன்ட் டு தி சேஞ்சஸ் இன் கேபிடல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் இஃப் கேபிடல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் சேஞ்சஸ் நோ வேல்யூ ஆஃப் ஷேர் இட் மே சேஞ்ச் ஆர் மே நாட் சேஞ்ச் தட் இஸ் இண்டிபெண்டன்ட் நோ இண்டிபெண்டன்ட் ப்ரொவைடட் நோ டாக்ஸ் நோ காஸ்ட் ஆஃப் கேபிடல் So no tax, no cost of capital for the company. Even the capital changes or capital structure is changes. Market value or equity share is independent. Even there is an increase in the structure, percentage changes in the structure. It is not going to affect the equity share because independent. So MM Naipaul is very clear. It's a two proposition. Proposition one, value of the firm and cost of capital are independent of capital structure. Okay. So cost of capital and the value of the firm are independent. So cost of capital high, value different. Cost of capital low, value is different. There is no relationship, independent. So cost of capital, value of the firm are independent. Proposition one, assumption one. Cost of equity increases because use of debt, cheaper debt. If debt is cheaper, cost of equity increases. It is going to offset. If cost of equity is higher, better use cheaper debt. So 20% you have to return, give it to the shareholders. So better get 5% debt, why you have to pay 20% equity? So just bring in money, 5% debt. 5% debt will be cheaper, no? Then 20% equity. 20% you have to pay return to the shareholders. 5% you can pay interest. But debt will be cheaper than equity. You think an option. Suppose if cost of equity is increase, use cheaper debt. If cost of equity increase, use cheaper debt. Okay. So automatically, that's a combination permutation idea. The company can use it. The firm use debt. Use of debt will increase because it's cheaper debt. Low interest, 4% interest, 5% interest. Cost of equity, 18%, 15% you have to pay return. Always use cheaper debt. So equity cost will be coming down. That's it. Assumptions. So investors are free to buy and sell the securities. In the securities are trading in the perfect market. So investors are free to buy and sell the securities. Anytime they can buy and sell the securities. The perfect market. The expectation investors are same and homogeneous. All the investors have the same mindset. Return. They are all same kind of knowledge. Homogeneous group. That's it. Group. The firm can be classified into homogeneous risk class. Homogeneous risk class. Same mindset, same kind of risk they are going to face it. Homogeneous. Heterogeneous means different mindset. My mindset different, your mindset different. Heterogeneous mindset. Homogeneous, no? Same kind of investor, same kind of expectation, same kind of returns. Same mindset, homogeneous. So these firms are called homogeneous risk class. They are expecting dividend payout ratio 100%. 100% dividend payout. What are the company they are having earnings? 100% dividend they are giving. Earnings 100 rupees, dividend 100 rupees. 100% dividend payout. Earnings 100, dividend 100. That's it. No corporate taxes. These are the assumptions under MM modeling approach. But these are the five different assumptions under MM approach. Under MM approach. That's it. So proposition one, market value firm, cost of capital are independent. Proposition two, if cost of equity increases, use cheaper debt. That's it. That's the idea. Homogeneous market, homogeneous investors, payout ratio, dividend pay ratio 100%, no corporate taxes. Any investor can come and buy and sell the securities in the perfect market. At their will, they can buy and sell the securities. Anytime the investors will come to the company, they may buy, they may sell the securities. That's it. Let's see. 2004 paper. What is the relation between cost of equity and financial leverage occurs in MM proposition 2, right? So proposition 2 says, use cheaper debt if either rather than increase in cost of equity. If cost of equity is more, don't raise cost of equity. Use cheaper debt because debt will be cheaper, no? Always there is a cheaper debt available. The firm will focus only on cheaper debt rather than focusing only on increase in equity. If increase in equity, no, the company has to use cheaper debt rather than increase in equity. If they have to offset the portion. Whatever their equity, equity always reduce it. Debt portion increase it. That's it. Change of percentage. 60% equity, 40% debt. Now, 30% equity, 70% debt. Change. Just change. 20% equity, 80% debt. Change. So, use of debt increases the cost of equity as well. That's it. Okay, fine. Sometimes the debt you are using, cheaper debt. Okay. So, use of debt increases the cost of equity as well. Sometimes. Not always, sometimes. So, generally, the purpose of equity debt will be cheaper. So, using. So, cost of equity somewhat will minimize it. But sometimes on the there are some people say, no. Equity you're buying. Our equity will also, they're expecting higher returns also. Sometimes shareholders expect higher returns. In this case, cost of equity also higher. Otherwise, we can say in different way also. Even the debt usage also, you have to give more return to the shareholders. That is also possibility. Anyway, cost of equity is nothing but overall cost of capital the company having plus risk premium. How much risk the company is going to pay extra risk premium. Overall cost of capital plus risk premium equal to KE. For example, overall cost of capital 10%, risk premium 3% assumption, 13% cost of equity. So overall cost of capital plus risk premium equal to KE. That's what MM proposition 2 says. Okay, that's it. Risk premium extra money, extra risk. That's it. Yes, risk premium, there is a different format available. So risk premium is equivalent to overall cost of capital minus cost of equity. Equity into debt by shareholder funds. Debt by shareholder funds ratio. KO minus KE into debt by shareholder funds equal risk premium. That's it. So overall cost of capital plus risk premium extra is equal cost of equity. Overall cost of capital will be cheaper than cost of equity. Plus risk premium extra 3% you have to pay for equity holders. overall cost will be cheaper than cost of equity. Overall cost of capital will be cheaper than cost of equity. Now, extra 3% risk premium. That's it. Let's see. There's a relationship here. See, overall cost of capital, KO. Overall cost of capital, KO. It's called WACC. Weighted average cost of capital. Cost of debt. Cost of equity. Cost of equity, cost of debt. Right. So, ultimate point, your overall cost of capital plus the risk premium. Risk premium. That is equal to KE. See the line? Cost of EKE will be higher. K will be lower. Below that, cost of debt will be cheaper. Cheaper debt, KO higher than cheap debt, KE higher than KO. So, KO plus risk premium is equal to cost of equity. KO plus risk premium is equal to cost of equity. So, KO suppose 10, risk premium 3, cost of equity 15. Apo KO higher than KD, KE higher than KO. That's the relationship. MI for these two say, KE will be higher than KO, K will be higher than KD. That's it. This is the relationship, MM thesis, MM assumption. MM assumption, assumption, that's it. KE more than KO, KO more than KD. That's it. So what is assumption? Free to buy, free to sell in the perfect market. Anybody can come, anybody can buy, anybody can make a sale. That's it. Homogeneous investors are available in the market. Risk also homogeneous risk class available. The payout, the dividend payout ratio of the company is under MM IBA is 100%. What are the earnings they are having? 100% they have to hand it back to the shareholders. But no corporate taxes, no corporate taxes. And dividend payout ratio also 100%. No corporate taxes, no corporate taxes. That's it. So cost of equity more than KO, more than KD. One mark ma? See, memorize the line. One mark KE more than KO, more than KD under MM IBA. Cost of equity more than overall cost of capital. Cost of capital, overall cost of capital more than cost of debt. That's it. So KE is equal to KO plus a risk premium. Risk premium. One mark. So cost of equity is equal to overall cost of capital plus risk premium. Extra they have to pay. That's it. Okay. Same already we explained. 2-7 paper. What are assumptions of Montague Miller theory? 2 marks. Same. Under the assumption, under MM theory is under the assumption it's operating. Absence of corporate taxes. Absence of cost of capital. In the cost of market value of equity shares, they are independent to the changes in capital structure or degree of leverages. Imagine there is no corporate tax. Imagine there is no cost of capital. Imagine there is no market value of equity shares. Upper changes in capital structure are independent. Under the two as a proposition, MM is operating upon. Number one, firm market value of the firm and cost of capital are independent. So use cheaper debt than increase in cost of equity. Use cheaper debt than increase in cost of equity. Okay, right. Sometimes, usage of debt, more equity cost also increases. Sometimes, in other words, sometimes the firm uses the debt, it is going to increase the cost of equity also because you're not getting cheaper equity. Using the debt, by the way, you're not going to get cheaper equity also sometimes, okay? But automatically, use of debt also sometimes increases the use of equity also. Here, any investor can buy and sell the securities, perfect market. Again, same homogeneous consumer mind, homogeneous investor mindset, homogeneous risk class they belongs to. Whatever dividend the company earning, 100%, they will pay out, dividend payout, no corporate taxes. That's the assumption. So on the basis of assumption only, the company is operating upon. That's it. Okay. 2-7 paper. What is net operating income approach? NOI theory, capital structure. NOI theory, capital structure. NOI theory. My net operating income approach. The theory. According to net operating income approach, market value of the firm depends upon the net operating income or EBIT and WACC. That's what. Okay, right. So, value of the firm depends upon the EBIT and overall cost of capital. Under net operating income approach, it totally depends on EBIT is net operating income and overall cost of capital, WACC. Weighted average cost of capital depends upon. Our company having a proper mix. Okay, right. Our financing mix, capital is irrelevant, but does not affect the value of the firm. Under the theory, you can do any mix, debt 60, 40, any mix you can do it. Anyway, it is not going to affect the value of the firm. That's the main theoretical process. So under net operating income approach, any percentage mix you can use it, it is not going to affect the firm value. So 60% debt, 40% equity, you can use it, no problem. It is not going to affect the value of the firm according to net operating income approach. So 40% equity, 60% debt, you can use it, not going to affect the value of the firm. So any combination, permutation mix you can use it, but it is not going to affect the value of the firm. That's the net operating income approach says. See, the market value of the firm is not affected by the capital structure changes. If the capital structure changes, firm, the market value of the firm not affected. For given value of EBIT, the value of the firm remains the same irrespective of capital composition. Okay. So given level of EBIT, the firm remains irrespective of the capital composition. That's it. Okay. Right. Above given of EBIT, the firm value remains same. Whatever be the value of EBIT, firm will remain same. That's called this theory says. However, this theory says it depends upon WACC. So given value of EBIT, the firm never changes, same value. It all depends upon the overall cost of capital, weighted average cost of capital, the firm having. That's a part. Okay. Graphic representation. Here also, KE more than KO, more than KD. Here, under net operating income approach, NOI approach, your cost of capital and your KD are constant. Okay. What will be the debt equity mix? So debt is 60, equity 40, no problem. So debt to 40, equity 60, no problem. What will be the debt equity mixer? Your KO and KD become same, constant. See the line? Linear. So debt equity mix changes, same KO, same KD. But KD will be always cheaper than KO, but they are all same. That's it. Same. All leverages. Leverage increases. KE increases. More leverage, more KE. But KO and KD, same. That's the net operating income approach very clearly says. Okay, right. So in this approach, your overall cost of capital and your debt cost, same. But your KE will change. More leverage, more KE. So more leverage, more KE, more cost of equity. That's it. What is leverage? The mix is called leverage. Debt to 40, equity 60. Similarly, 40, 60. That's it. Anyway, it's going to affect the KE, but not KO and KD. Debt to equity, you can change any percentage. It is going to affect the KE, not KO, KD. That's it. Assumption. WACC remains constant for all leverages. Under NOI approach, WACC is constant. I told you already KD is less than KD. Correct. KD is always less than KE. Leverage increases KE. More you leverage, more KE. KD, KO always. KD also constant. KO also constant. What's the relationship? KE more than KO, which is equal to KD. KO equal KD, but KE is more than KO, or which is equal to KD. No corporate taxes here also. 2012 paper. What is the net operating income approach of capital structure? Explain the assumptions on net operating is based upon. No relationship between cost of capital and value of the firm. I told you. Under NOI approach, no relation between cost of capital and value of the firm. So, value of the firm is independent of the capital structure. One mark, ma. Under NOI approach, market value of the firm is independent of the capital structure. Sir, I have a 60% debt, 40% equity. It is going to change the value of the firm? No. Firm value is independent of the capital structure according to NOI approach. One mark. Firm value, company value, independent of the capital structure. That's called NOI approach. Assumptions are NOI approach. No cost, no taxes. Overall cost of capital remains the same for all degrees of debt equity mix. My ever debt degree mix is available, overall cost of capital remains same. The market capitalizes the value of the firm as a whole. Okay. So market capitalization, entire firm value will become market capitalization. Apo, whether you have a debt equity mix is not important one. Irrespective of debt and equity mix, debt operating income remains no relation. I told you. So cost of capital and value of the firm, no relationship. Okay. Value of the firm and the capital structure are independent. That's it. But only one point. KE, which is more than KO, which is equal to KD, So increase in proportion of debt, capital structure leads to risk perception. See, more debt, risk increases, I can accept. By the way, it is going to increase the cost of equity also. More debt, more equity. More KO, more equity. That's it. Anyway, the debt is more, KE also more. So more debt, slight increase in the debt, increase in cost of equity also. Slight increase in the KD. Your KE also slightly increases. Anyway, cost of equity completely offsets the benefit of using cheaper debt. Because of cost of equity is higher, you have to forget about the cheap interest rate. It is going to offset the cheaper debt rate. Because of high cost of equity, it is going to offset the cheaper debt. The same thing, we'll do it again. Okay. See here, in the NOI approach, okay, right. See, if KO is equal to KD, K vehicle KD, which means same increase, same increase, same percentage of increase. So same percentage of increase. So obviously KO will be higher than KO. KO will be higher than KD only. But same percentage increase. So KE more than KO, KO more than KD. Percentage increase. Okay, right. Here also more percentage increase. More KD. Under both NOA and MM approach, more KD. There is no doubt at all. Under both approaches, Okay. Let's see. 2003 page 6th paper. Discuss the major consideration, the capital structure planning. Six marks. So any capital structure planning, if you have now, you have to think about three parameters. Risk in the capital structure, cost of capital and control. These are three things you have to always think about. Risk factor, cost of capital and control. Risk is a situation. So something may be happening or may not be happening. It can be measured. Risk means certainty. 20% chance, 80% chance, risk. There is a certainty, reasonable certainty, risk. Uncertainty, it is not a risk. No probability. Probability can be assigned a risk. Probability cannot be assigned a, it is not a risk. So 50% chance we may win, 50% chance we may lose. Probability, certainty, 50-50, upper risk. Sir, I may not know what is the percentage of winning. Uncertainty, upper no risk. Uncertainty, no risk. Certainty, risk. That's what actually can be measured by probability you can assign. Probability can be assigned a risk. So 60% we may win, 40% we may lose. But risk is 60%. That's it. 60-40. With reference to capital structure planning, risk may be defined as the variability in the actual return from an investment. Return from the investment. Estimated forecast. Time of capital structure planning. We have to think about the risk factor while designing our capital structure. While we designing our optimal capital structure of debt equity preference, as the risk we have to carry down. We may not know what is going to happen tomorrow. Uncertainty. We know exactly what is going to happen. 60% we may win, 40% chance we may lose risk. For any designing a capital structure, the firm try to keep the risk always at the minimum risk you try to carry. 20% risk, 30% risk, 40% risk. Minimize the risk always. So cost of capital means minimize the rate of return that the firm earns investment to side various investors. You try to keep your cost of capital should be minimum. Your return should be maximum. Your cost should be minimum. That's the idea. Of ultimate point of every company, every organization, minimize the cost, maximize the return to the shareholders. So cost is an important consideration in capital structure planning. So cost is thus an important consideration in capital structure planning. That's very, very important. Okay, well, it's very important for capital structure planning. Number three, control. The decisions relating to capital structure are taken after keeping the control factor in mind. So decisions relating to any capital structure are taken after keeping the capital control factor in mind. For example, when equity shares are issued, the company automatically dilutes its controlling. When equity shares are issued, the company automatically dilutes its controlling. That's it. Now, okay, well, fine. Okay. So when the equity shares are issued, the company dilutes its controlling, right? Because it is the shareholders are controlling the things. That's it. Upper higher debt, more control. Lower debt, higher equity. Control also passing through shareholders. When equity shares are issued, control passing to shareholders. Upper they taking ultimate control. They are real owners. Upper automatically dilute the controlling, shareholders will take. Upper there are three important parameters in capital structure: risk, cost of capital, and control. Risk, cost of capital and control. Minimize the risk. Minimize the cost of control. And finally, it's a control factor. Whenever the company issuing equity shares, controls are automatically going to be diluted. Less control. Dilute in the control. That's it. More share equity shares, dilute in control. That's it. What are fundamental principles of capital governing capital structure? Governing capital structure. Number one, cost principle. Every aim of the company organization, the ideal pattern of any capital structure, minimize the cost of capital. Maximize the EPS. Minimize the cost. Number two, minimize the risk. Upper you try to make a balance between equity and finance capital and the debt. Excessive usage of debt sometimes leading to excessive cost of equity also. You try to maintain the balance. Okay. Use more and more debt means higher commitment in the forms of interest payout, more and more loan borrowed, higher interest commitment. Loan over loan, more and more loan borrowed, no, higher interest commitment. Low loan borrowing, low interest commitment. That's it. So more and more you borrowed, more and more you have to pay interest, leads to erosion to shareholders' value. In unfair business situation, it leads to erosion to shareholders in the unfair business situation. Erosion. Shareholders' value has been eroded in unfavorable business situation. That's called risk principle. Erosion of shareholders' value in unfair business situation is called risk principle. That's it. Okay. So use if you're using more and more debt, more interest payment, more and more interest payment. Up a less profit we are having. Up value of the shareholders will be decreasing. Earnings will be decreasing. More interest, less earnings. Shareholders' value also going to be decreased. Earning per share also going to be decreased. EPS is also decreased. Next, number 3, control principle. While designing capital structure, always you have to think about the control. I told you, ownership remains undisturbed. Suppose whenever issuing equity shares, whenever the company issues equity shares, so they're going to dilute the control. They're going to dilute the control. Flexibility. If the management chooses such a combination source of planning, which means they can do accordingly. Flexibility they may have. Debt, equity, preference shares, just like this. Different combination of everything they can go according to the cost of nature. That's it. Sometimes the other factors of the company will take it. What time we can issue, what time we can compete, what kind of industry we belongs to. So other factors of the company will take care for the capital structure governing. Okay. So there are other things. Cost principle, risk principle, control principle, flexibility and other consideration. So that also will be taken into account. That's what normally they will doing. Okay. Fine. Okay. Let's see 2009 paper. Theory only. Okay. Discuss the concept of debt equity or EBS, EBT indifference point. But debt equity or EBD EPS indifference point. That's it. What is EBD EPS? What is EBD EPS? Right. I told you vertical form of sales form. Correct? The same thing you can do it by horizontal format also. Horizontal format also you can go for it. Right. That is, this is a format, vertical format. So sale minus variable cost, contribution. Minus fixed cost, EBIT, minus interest, EBT, minus tax, PAT, minus PD, earnings, I told you. Correct? No? Earnings. So, earnings per share is equal to earnings by number of equity shares outstanding. This is vertical format. Same thing, horizontal format. Horizontal. What is horizontal format? EBIT, minus interest, into 1 minus tax rate. Minus PD by number of equity shares outstanding, that is equal to EPS. EPS, that is equal to EPS. Okay, EPS. Above the company have two different plans. First plan is debt to equity. Second plan is debt to equity preference shares. Two different plans the company have. First plan is debt to equity. Second plan is debt to equity preference shares. First plan is debt to equity. Second plan debt to equity preference shares. First plan they may have EPS one. What is point of indifference? Very simple. Indifference point means EPS of the two different plans all equal. EPS of the two different plans must be equal. Plan 1, debt to equity. Assumption. Plan 2, debt to equity preference shares. Anyway, EPS 1, EPS 2 of two different plans must be equal. If two EPS equal, what is EBAT? That's it. To find EBAT, this is the concept. EBAT, horizontal format. Minus interest 1 into 1 minus tax rate minus PD 1 by number of equity shares outstanding. Here also EBAT. Minus interest to into 1 minus tax rate minus PD2 by number of equity shares outstanding. Anyway, EBAT is equal to question mark that we can find out. What level of EBAT? EPS under two plans must be equal. It's called indifference point. What level of EBAT? EPS under two different plans must be equal. That question is called EBAT. That point is called EBAT. That's it. Okay, ma. EBAT minus interest 1, interest 2, number of shareholders 1, number of shareholders 2, tax rate. That's it. Okay, right. Here I'm saying N1, N2, they're saying E1, E2. That's it. This is N1. N1 is N2. Number of equity shares outstanding 1, equity shares outstanding 2. That's it. So let's see overcapitalization, 2013 paper. state the causes and consequences, 4 marks. For capitalization, when a firm has consistently been unable to earn the prevailing rate of return on its capital employed, the situation is termed as overcapitalization. See, I raised a lot of money, but I am unable to use the money. Invested assets, I am not using my assets properly. I am unable to pay that interest. I am unable to pay the dividend. I am inability. Money received, excess capitalization, but I am not able to use the capitalization. I am not able to use the assets. My level of equity is not sufficient. Insufficient. My level of equity is insufficient to pay the debt interest and pay the other things. It is, and I am unable to pay the dividend, unable to pay the interest. I am unable to earn the money because of overcapitalization. Apo, overcapitalized, I am unable to use the money for the productive usage, productive payment of interest and dividend. That's called overcapitalization. Your actual earning will be less than the rate of earning, current rate of earning. That's a parameter. Your real value will be less than book value because overcapitalization. If any company overcapitalization, they are unable to pay the interest and the dividend, these companies are overcapitalization. They are not using the assets properly. They are not using resources properly. Their actual earnings will be less than the current rate of earnings. Real value of business will be less than the book value of business. That's it. Okay. So what are the reasons for overcapitalization? Overcapitalization. Okay. So if the rate of capitalization is underestimated, its situation is called leading to overcapitalization. The capitalization rate is underestimated. You are not estimating properly. The capitalization rate is underestimated. It is called overcapitalization. Your capitalization rate is underestimated. It's called overcapitalization. What is overcapitalization? Layman term is nothing but the amount you received, not able to use it properly, not using your assets properly, unable to make a payment of interest, dividend. That's called overcapitalization. Overissue of capital. Sometimes company can issue no more shares. More shares. With overestimation of financial requirements. We thought we may use such amount of money. Sorry, but we are not unable to use the money properly. More capital raised. Then what is actually real? I need only 10 crores, but I raised 100 crores. I need only 10 crores, but I raised 100 crores. What purpose? No purpose. Resulting in overcapitalization. Sometimes lot of promotion expenses incurred. The company incurred a lot of promotional expenses. Excessive preliminary incorporate expenses over. More incorporate expense has been done. More promotion expense has been done because of overcapitalization. The company have a liberal dividend policy. The company might have followed the lenient dividend policy without bothering much about building up the reserves. Okay. So without building up the reserves, lenient dividend policy they applied, which means the company does not have any return earnings. Nothing is available. They are unable to pay the dividend. No. They are unable to pay the interest, unable to pay the dividend. They don't have any return earnings. It is effectively because of the liberal dividend policy. Without building the reserves, the company, sometimes what is the earnings? They're paying the dividend. Without building the reserves, overall rate earnings will become eroded. Similarly, adequate provision might not be made for the depreciation assets. You're not making proper provision for depreciation of the assets. You may not know what is your real value than book value. Your real value of the assets will be less than the book value of assets. You're not planning properly depreciation of the assets. Depreciation provision, you're not maintaining. Depreciation provision, you're not maintaining. Inadequate depreciation, you're not maintaining it. That's it. So company formation, company during inflationary period. So already prices are skyrocketing. This is the time you form the company. Once a company is floated during inflation time, large funds are required for necessary assets. So this is inflation time. Prices are skyrocketing. You floating a company now. You purchase assets at high price you paid because inflation. Okay. So when the depreciation sets in, the prices are already higher price you purchased because of overcapitalization. Inflation time, if you start the business, everything will be high. Later stage, depreciation starts. Your price of assets will be high, leading to overcapitalization. So what happened to the overcapitalization of the company? Poor credit worthiness. When the company unable to pay, they can get a loans, a cheaper rate of interest. But the earnings are reduced, no. Unable to pay the interest, no. Credit worthiness will be diluted because of overcapitalization. Inability to pay interest, overcapitalization. Our earnings are not enough to pay the interest. our credit worth of the company will be diluted. You are unable to pay the interest. Once the company unable to pay dividend interest, image is coming down in the market. So they have difficulties in obtaining the capital. For a company faced situation of overcapitalization, it is very difficult for the company to further capital for the growth and extension programs. It's very tough for the company for the growth and extension programs, expansion programs. See, because credit worthiness down, again, you are not getting the capital. Again, very difficult for you to obtain the capital. Because of this, you cannot go for any growth and expansion program. All investors lost confidence in you. That's it. Similarly, loss of goodwill. Goodwill has been completely lost. Because of fall in market price of the shares, goodwill lost. Okay, right. Now, automatically, the company has to sell the shares below face value, to improve the goodwill in the market. Now, automatically, below 100 rupees shares, now 90 they have to issue, 95 they have to issue. Below par value only they have to issue. The company can go for it. Because goodwill, they lost it. They lost the market share also. Overcapitalization leads to market share. So, company cannot able to produce the competitive cost. Our competitors are producing at a cheaper cost, but we are producing at a higher cost. Automatically, we're losing the market also. We're losing to competitors. We're losing the market share. Goodwill lost. Unable to obtain the money in the front of capital market. Credit worthiness. I'm not unable to pay the payment interest properly. Our last choice, the company has to go for liquidation. Liquidation company. All overcapitalized company will go into liquidation. Automatically, some steps you have to take to reorganize your company. But because fear of closing, down the business. So you're not going to liquidate the company. Your fear of losing the company's shares. You're going to liquidate your company. Reorganize your capital structure. Apo, you try to prevent the liquidation. You do a lot of things you have to do to prevent the liquidation of the company. That's it. Let's see. 2009 paper, capital structure theory. Using MM hypothesis, okay. 2008 paper, 3 marks. So there are two firms, P and Q. They are identical in every aspect. But P does not use debt in the capital structure. But Q has a debt, 8 lakhs, 9% debt in the capital structure. So P, no debt, Q having debt. But same kind of business they're doing, same kind of capital structure they're having. Both the firms have a EBIT, earning before interest and taxes, 2,60,000 per annum. Both firms. The capitalization rate, 10% capitalization rate. So 10% capitalization rate for both the firms. Right. Assuming the corporate tax of 30%. What is the value of the firms according to MM hypothesis? That's the question. Okay. So P and Q, they are in the market. P and Q on the market. They are identical in every aspect. Same kind of business they're doing. Identical in every aspect. But P having no debt, no loan. But Q having a debt, So Q having a debt of 8 lakhs, interest 9%. Here no debt, no interest. But everything remains same. Earning before interest and tax for the both the firms remain same. Here also rupees 2,60,000 per annum. Here also EBIT 2,60,000 per annum. Okay, both same. So capitalization rate same. So capitalization rate also same. Okay, same. So they have a same capitalization rate. Okay. So it's going to be how much more? 10%. 10% capitalization rate. Same. 10%. So tax rate is same. 30% tax rate. Same. That's it. So question. What is the value of the firm according to MM hypothesis? Modigli Miller hypothesis, which firm having a more value? Very simple. A company having a debt, having a more value. A company having a debt, more value in the market, according to MM hypothesis. Company having a debt. So without fail, I can say Q company having more value. But both doing same EBIT, both capitalization debt, both same business, both same tax they have to pay, but only P having no debt, Q having debt. One company having a debt, having higher value in the market, ultimately. That's it. More higher value. Sir, how to find ma? Okay. So P firm is called unlevered firm. Unlevered firm. Because they don't have any loans. They're technically called unlevered. Q having a loan, technically they are called levered firms, levered, leverage, levered. A company having no loan is unlevered. Company having loan is levered, levered. That's it. Okay. First, we'll go to unlevered firm value, P value. Unlevered firm, which means a company having unlevered firm. A company having unlevered firm. Okay. Which means no debt, no debt, no debt company, no debt company. Which means company P, company P, company P. So how to find value of the company? So value of the firm for unlevered, 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 that is equal to earning before interest and taxes into 1 minus tax rate by cost of E, K, K or KO, K or KO, that's it. Because no debt, only equity, no debt means only equity, no debt means only equity, only equity. Only equity, so KE. What is the EBITDA firm P? 2,60,000. So please memorize my unlevered firm value formula. EBIT non-based tax rate by KE. Unlevered firm value. EBIT non-based tax rate by KE. Firm value. No debt, only equity. So EBIT value 2,60,000. 2,60,000. EBIT value 2,60,000. Into 1 minus tax rate. 30%. 30%. So cost of equity, 10%, 0.1, 0.1, 0.1. Please check it out. The answer is supposed to be ₹18,20,000. ₹18,20,000 in the market. This is a firm value because it is unlevered. Because it is unlevered. This is value of firm. Value of firm, it is going to be unlevered. Unlevered. Same business, they're doing it. But they have a loan, they don't have a loan. That's the difference. P don't have any loans, no debt, no debt. Unlevered firm. Q is a levered firm. Levered firm value. Very simple, levered firm value. Levered firm is Q. Q. So they have a debt. Debt using. They debt using. Very simple. So value of firm Q is equal to value of firm Q is equal to value of firm P. Firm P. Value of firm P. Firm P plus A. Plus A. Loan into tax rate. Loan into tax rate. That is the value. That's called MM hypothesis. MM hypothesis. According to MM hypothesis, MM hypothesis, any company using loan, unlevered firm value plus loan into tax rate. What is unlevered firm value? Unlevered firm value. 18,20,000 is unlevered firm value. P means unlevered firm. 18,20,000 unlevered firm value. Plus, how much loan they are having, ma? How much loan they are having, ma? 8 lakhs loan they are having. 8 lakhs loan they are having. 8 lakhs loan they are having. So, 8 lakhs loan they are having into 30% tax rate. 30% tax rate. So, 18,20,000. 8 lakh into 30%, 2,40,000. That's it. 18,20,000 plus 2,40,000. Overall total is going to be exam paper. So, 20,60,000. So, 20,60,000. That's it. This is firm Q value. Q value. So firm P value plus loan into tax rate, firm Q value. So 20,60,000. That's it. That's it. Which means according to MM hypothesis, a company having a loan, more value in the market than the company without having loan. This company without loan, firm P, unlevered, unlevered. Firm P, unlevered. Value of the firm or P. Firm P, unlevered. It is going to be 18,20,000. Firm Q, levered, levered, levered. So value of the firm P, unlevered firm value, please memorize my unlevered firm value, into plus loan into tax rate. What is the loan? 8 lakhs. They have a debt, debt 8 lakhs into 30% tax rate, value added. So according to MM hypothesis, any company having a loan, please add value to that. A company does not have a loan, don't add value to that. Any company having a loan, higher value in the market according to MM hypothesis. How to find value of the firm? EBIT unlevered tax rate by KE. That's it. Let's see. So 2012 paper. Okay. 5 marks. RS Limited is all equity finance company. Entire finance is going to be equity finance only, equity company only. With the market capitalization of 25 lakhs. So all values are equity value, equity only, equity value. That's it. All values are equity value, rupees 25 lakhs, rupees 25 lakhs. All equity value, rupees 25 lakhs. Right. So cost of equity, 21%. The company wants to buy back equity shares, 5 lakhs. Why is the company going for buyback? They have surplus cash. they want to reduce the shareholders. After buyback, within 1 week, share shall be cancelled. They want to buy back 5 lakh. For the buyback of 5 lakhs, the company going to raise 15% per share, same amount. Okay. So buyback share value. Buyback value rupees 5 lakhs. For 5 lakh buyback, they want money. Correct? They want money. For this, they want going to issue 15% debt, perpetual debt. Debt, same amount, rising same amount, 5 lakhs. 5 lakhs loan borrowed to repay the buyback. So for buyback equity shares, they want money 5 lakhs. For this, rising loan 5 lakhs to repay the buyback. Okay. Rate of tax must supposed to be 30%. 30% rate of tax. So the company is going to restructure the capital. Restructuring the capital. Alteration of capital. Equity debt, they're altering it. Now no equity shares. Debt comes in. No equity shares. 5 lakhs. 5 lakhs. They're cancelling 5 lakhs. Rising debt. Cancelling 5 lakhs. Rising debt. Alteration of capital structure. In this case, what is the market value of Aries Limited? Question number 1. Question number 2. What is the cost of equity? Question number 3, what is weighted average overall cost of capital? Now the structure has been changed. So earlier debt, earlier equity, pure equity. Now debt plus equity. Earlier equity, now debt plus equity. So what is the overall cost of capital? Overall, that's it. Okay. So now how to apply? Right. That's a very interesting question, ma. Okay. Now everything is given. K equal to 21% given. Right. So initially it is going to be full equity company. Everything is a full equity company. Okay. So market value of equity that is equal to rupees 25 lakhs. Market value of equity rupees 25 lakhs. So cost of equity 21%. Okay. Right. Now. So cost of equity 21%. See this idea. EBIT minus interest. EBT minus tax. So PAT minus PD earnings. Minus PD earnings. Okay. Minus PD earnings. That's it. Please check it. Minus PD earnings. Right. So now that's idea. Right. Okay. Now. So all equity, therefore no interest. Anyway, tax you have to pay at the rate of. So 30% tax you have to pay. Your PAT. So PAT is equal to net income. This is net operating income. This is net income. PAT is called net income. Right. Okay. So equity value is given. 21% capitalization rate is given. Okay. Right. Now, net income by KE. Net income means amount goes to shareholders only. Net income because all equity. Our PD also zero. Interest also zero. PD also zero. But this is called net income. Entire income will go to equity holders only. The net income by KE is equal to market value. Okay, right. Market value, everything is equity only. Market value is equity. Net income, I don't know. But KE, I know, 21%. Right. Can you cross multiply? So already market equity, already we know, that is called 25 lakhs. Can you substitute? 25 lakhs. Our 25 lakhs into 21%. So 25 lakhs into 21%. That is equal to 5,25,000 net income. My net income is going to be 5,25,000 net income. Net income for the company, 5,25,000 net income. If it is fully equity, that is a net income. Fully equity. 5,25,000 net income. Okay. Suppose if it is net income, here also 5,25,000. Here also 5,25,000. So this is 70% tax. Of 100%, you have to find out. Okay. So 70% age, 5,25,000. What about 100% age? Question mark. 100 will 70 into 5,20,000. Answer for this one. 100 by 70 into 5,20,000 is going to be 7,50,000. I think. Please check it out. So 5,20,000 by 0.7 or 7.5 lakh. It's going to be 7.5 lakhs. Here also 7.5 lakhs. 7.5 lakhs. Okay. Reverse working. Net operating income is nothing but PAT or earnings. PAT or earnings. So PAT or earnings, net income. Net income. PAT or earnings. Then net operating income or EBAT that is equal to 7.5 lakhs. Our EBAT is known as 7.5 lakhs. So fully equity. What is EBAT? 7.5 lakhs. The company fully equity. What is EBAT of the company? 7.5 lakhs. Once you know KE and market liquidity, you can find EBAT, 7.5 lakhs. Fully EBAT, you know EBAT, 7.5 lakhs. That's a case one. But now they want to cancel 5 lakhs buyback. Now they want to cancel buyback. Okay. In this case, option 2, buyback. Out of 25 lakhs, okay, they want to reduce 5 lakhs buyback. They want to reduce buyback 5 lakhs. So buyback 5 lakhs. In this case, balance 20 lakhs equity. So balance the company having 20 lakhs equity. Option 2. The company having buyback 5 lakhs, 20 lakhs they're having equity. Again, buyback 5 lakhs, 20 lakhs equity. Our balance of 5 lakhs debt. Debt they're going for 5 lakhs. The debt the company going for 5 lakhs. The company going for debt 5 lakhs. My debt company going for 5 lakhs. Please check it out. That's it. Okay, fine. Okay. So anyway, 5 lakhs is a, that's a point, 5 lakhs, okay. Okay, now, for question, question, 5 lakhs is a debt, okay. In this case, how to proceed, okay, that's a point, debt to 5 lakhs, okay. So there are two options, the company having two options, particulars, all equity, option one, everything is equity, option one, option two, debt equity mix. Option 2, debt equity mix, because 20 lakhs equity debts. Option 2, debt equity mix. Debt equity mix. Superb sum. See, debt equity mix. Option all equity. Option 2, debt equity mix. Okay. Anyway, both category, the EBT remains same. For both category, EBT remains same. EBT becomes 7.5 lakhs only. EBT 7.5 lakhs for both. Minus interest. This is purely all equity company, no interest. But here they have interest. How much is a loan? 5 lakhs. For 5 lakhs, how much you have to pay interest? 15%. 15% interest you have to pay. 5 lakhs, 15% interest you have to pay. So 5 lakhs, okay? 15% interest you have to pay. So 5 lakh into 15% is going to be 75,000 interest you have to pay. Okay, right. Please subtract 7.5 lakhs here. 7,50,000 minus 65, 6,75,000 here. EBT minus interest, EBT. EBT. EBT minus interest, EBT. 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 So they have interest, EBT. EBT. Okay. Minus taxes. 30% taxes. So 30% taxes. 7.5 lakhs into 30%. 7.5 lakhs into 30%. So 2,25,000. 7.5 lakhs into 30%, 2,25,000. 2,20,000. Please check it out. 2,25,000. Here, 6,75,000 to 30%. 6,75,000. 30,000 into 30%. 30%. So it's going to be 2,02,500. 2,02,500. That's it. So 2,02,500. Taxes. EBT minus tax, PAT. Profit after tax, PAT. PAT is going to be 7,50,000 minus 2,25,000. 5,25,000. 5,25,000 PAT. Here is going to be 4,72,500. 4,70,500. 4,70,500. That's it. It's a PAT. 4,70,500. PAT. Is there any preference dividend? Sorry, not available. Our entire earnings will go to shareholders under option one. Under option two, option one, 5,20,000 will go to shareholders, equity earnings. Here 4,22,500 will go to equity earnings. Here equity earnings 5,25,000. Here equity earnings 4,22,500. Equity earnings. Right. That's it. Okay. Now is the income statement. Okay. So we'll do one by one all the question. Okay. What is the market value of REC Limited after reconstruction, after buyback and loan borrowed, what is the market value of REC? First question they are asking you. Okay. All right, we'll do one by one slowly. Okay, number one, market value of company before buyback, because before buyback all equity only, before buyback all equity only, therefore rupees 25 lakhs market value of equity, already given in the question, don't change the question, already given in the question, 25 lakhs market value before buyback. So question is, second question, they are asking you market value of company after buyback and after getting loan. That's the question actually. Okay, so market value of company after buyback and loan borrowed. Now debt equity mix. Okay, that is equal to, okay, this is unlevered company. Why? No debt. Here levered company, why? Debt. Levered company, why? Debt. So they are having higher value. Simple. Equity value, same market value of equity, rupees 25 lakhs plus loan into tax amount. Okay, loan amount how much, ma? I think 5 lakhs. 5 lakhs only loan. Okay, buyback and 5 lakhs loan. Okay, 5 lakhs only loan. Correct? Fine. 5 lakhs loan. Okay, 5 lakhs loan. So 5 lakhs loan. 25 lakhs minus 5 lakhs. 20 lakhs plus 5 lakhs loan. 5 lakhs buyback, 5 lakhs loan. So 5 lakhs loan into 30% tax rate. So 25 lakhs plus 5 lakh into 30,000, 1.5 lakhs. So answer 26,50,000. This is market value of equity after buyback. After buyback, this is the value. That's a question actually. 26,50,000. Okay. So the first question answer, 26,50,000. That is after buyback. 26, because loan into tax rate value increased. 26,50,000. That's the first question. Second question, what is cost of equity? This is also after buyback only. After buyback only, these questions, buyback. Okay. My second question is, so cost of equity. After buyback. That's called KE. Okay. Now tell me, in few debt equity mix. Okay, right. So debt equity mix. How much earnings available to shareholders? 4,70,500 earnings available to shareholders. Correct? Fine. Earnings available to shareholders. Debt equity mix. That's the second category. Okay. Is equal to earnings. Cost of equity is equal to earnings. This is a debt equity mix. Earnings available to equity holders into market value of equity into 100. So that earnings is the debt equity mix. 4,70,500. 4,70,500. in case one le, we found a market le company 26 lakh 50 thousand, okay, right? So 26 lakh 50 thousand is the value of the company, value of the firm, value of company. So value of company, so 26 lakh 50 thousand. Out of 26 lakh 50 thousand, 26,000, 20,000 loan 5 lakhs, don't change. So our balance 21 lakh 50 thousand, equity value changed. Okay, loan into tax amount will go to equity holders only. Loan into tax will go to equity holders only. About 20 lakh 50 thousand is the equity holders value. Value after buyback. After buyback, loan 5 lakhs, balance 21 lakh 50 thousand, equity value. Balance 21 lakh 50 thousand, equity value into 100. Into 100. So 4 lakh 2500 out of 20 lakh 50 thousand value. That percentage. So percentage approximately. So 21.9%, I think, approximately. 21.9% approximately. That's the second question. So 21.9% approximately. So 21.9% approximately. Super point. Earnings by market liquidity in 100, 21.9%. Fine. Second one. Okay. So third one. What is the WACC and comment on it? What is WACC and comment on it? Very simple. Already we are familiar with the WACC model. Lot of problems is solved earlier. More than 20 sums is solved. 20 sums more than 20. Okay. So number three, you have to find weighted average cost of capital, KO. So KO, we required 5 columns. Source, amount, proportion, source. 5 columns required for cost of capital. Source, amount, proportion, after tax cost, and WACC, KO. Correct? Source, they have a debt and equity. That's it. Debt 5 lakhs. Equity 21 lakh 50 thousand after buyback. So total 26 lakh 50 thousand total. Proportion should be always 1. Out of 26 lakh 50 thousand, what is the 5 lakhs amount? 5 lakhs amount? 5 lakhs by 26 lakh 50 thousand. You'll be getting a point of 0.22. Please check it 0.22. Okay, wow. Sorry. 5 lakhs. 5 lakhs. Point. Can you check the value? So 5 lakhs by 26 lakh 50 thousand into 100 is going to be 18.8%. I think 18.8. Please check it. 18.8. So 1 minus. Okay. Again, one more time. 5 lakhs by 26 lakh 50 thousand into 100. 18.8% approximately. So 0.188. Into 100 means or 0.188. So 5 lakhs by 26 lakh 50 thousand, 0.18, right? About 1 minus 0.8, 0.82. So 21 lakh 50 thousand by 26 lakh 50 thousand, approximately 0.82. By adding, you'll be getting 1, which means 18% you have debt, 82% you have equity. 18% the company having debt, 82% the company, 18% debt, 82% equity. Okay. You have to find cost of debt, KD. You have to find cost of KE. That's it. So cost of debt is equal to interest rate into 1 minus tax rate. Interest rate already we know, 15% interest rate. 15% interest rate we know. So please check your 15% interest rate. Okay. 15 into 1 minus tax rate. So tax rate is going to be 30%. 30%. 1 minus 0.3. 15 into 0.7. 15 into 0.7. So 15 into 0.7. That is equal to 10.5. So cost of debt, 10.5. Cost of debt. Cost of equity, just we found it. Cost of equity 21.9. Cost of equity 21.9. So cost of equity 21.9. Please multiply this first column, second column, third column, fourth column, fifth column. Fifth column is equal to overall cost of capital. 3 into 4. 0.18 into 10.5. 0.18 into 10.5. That is equal to 1.89. 0.82 into 21.9. that is equal to 17.958. Please add 17.958 plus 1.89 will be getting 19.8984% approximately. 19.84% approximately. 848% approximately. Please check it out. 19.848% approximately. This is called overall cost of capital. Overall cost of capital for the company. That's it. For the company, that's it. But there are three questions they're asking you. So overall cost of capital of the company, WACC, WACC overall cost. By raising debt and equity for the company, it is going to be 19.848%. So 19.848%. That's it. That's it. This overall cost of capital, KO. KO. That's it. Suppose let's see case two. Same revision. Market lady before buyback, all equity, unlevered, no debt, 25 lakhs. So market lady company of after buyback, loan borrowing, debt equity mixed. So the market lady equity plus the loan amount. Is market lady equity plus the loan amount, plus loan amount, 25 lakhs. 5 lakhs cut, 5 lakh rises, 25 lakhs. 5 lakhs debt, I mean equity cut, plus 5 lakhs comes in, 25 lakhs. Plus loan into tax rate, additional value, 1.5 lakhs. So 25 lakhs plus 1.5 lakhs is 26,50,000. That's a market company after buyback. Right. Okay. Next. So to enter now after buyback, the company value become 26,50,000. 50,000. That's it. 50,000 again. That's it. Out of 26,50,000, loan amount 5 lakhs. Balance equity what is amount. So cost of equity after buyback, earnings by market equity, 100. So 4,70,500 by 20,50,000 into 100. 4,75 is the earnings in debt equity mix structure. So equity value 25.50. So 21.9% cost equity. Case 3, WACC KO. So 5 columns you put after buyback. Source amount to proportion after tax cost WACC. Source debt 5 lakhs. Equity 21,50,000. My debt equity. 5 lakhs debt equity 21,50,000. Mixer. Percentage 5,20,50,000, 0.18. So 20,50,20,50, 0.82, 1 total. Cost of debt 10.5%. How do you come to know? I into 1 minus rate. That's the formula, please memory. Cost of debt, interest rate, 1 minus tax rate. It's a 15% interest. 1 minus tax rate, 10.5%. Cost of equity, 21.9. Already we put here. Already we put the value here. So 3 into 4 is 5. 0.18, 10.5. 0.82 21.9, please add it. So overall cost of capital for the company is going to be 19.848%. That's it. So three questions. This question has been asked 2 to 3 times examination. That's it. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, Style Digitech, and press the bell icon to see new videos.